House to adopt the motion?
Yes.
Carried. Ms. Matheson, seconded by Ms. Blaney, North Island Powell River, moves that a special committee of the House be appointed with the purpose of conducting hearings and proposing a plan for a postal banking system administered by the Canada Post Corporation. That this committee consists of 10 members, of which 6 shall be from the government party, 3 from the official opposition, and 1 from the New Democratic Party, provided that the chair is from the government party, that in addition to the chair, there be 1 vice chair from each of the recognized opposition parties, that the committee have all the powers of a standing committee as provided in the standing orders, that the members to serve on the said committee be appointed by the whip of each party by depositing with the clerk of the House a list of his or her party's members of the committee no later than a week after the adoption of the said motion, that the quorum of the committee be as provided for in Standing Order 118, provided that at least 1 member of each recognized party be present, that membership substitutions be permitted from time to time if required in the manner provided for in Standing Order 114.2, and that the committee report to the House no later than 12 months after the adoption of this motion. Debate. The Honourable Member for London Fanshawe.
Mr. Speaker, it gives me great pleasure as the NDP critic for Canada Post to bring this motion, M166, forward for debate today. In a country as vast and diverse as Canada, Canada Post is the jewel in the crown of public service corporations, providing the vital service that keeps us connected. And while the corporation and its workers have come under attack over the past few years, Canada Post continues to deliver. It is the first choice of countless vendors who, in this digital age, ship parcels ordered online from coast to coast to coast. We should recognize that the work of Canada Post is accomplished by workers, members of the Canadian Union of Postal Workers and the Canadian Postmasters and Assistants Association, who, despite the pressures of neoliberalism and globalization to privatize, continue to deliver quality public service that is accessible and affordable to all. I'm proud to be a member of this NDP caucus that has always supported labor rights and which understands that absolutely and without exaggeration, upholding those rights is fundamental to democracy. None of us can forget the spring of 2011 when the summer recess of this House was delayed because freedom of association and the right to organize and collectively bargain was under threat by the Conservative government of the day. A government that imposed back-to-work legislation on CUPW members who had been locked out by Canada Post. I encourage all members of this House to familiarize themselves with the speech given here by NDP leader Jack Layton in defense of the workers and in opposition to the legislation. In the meantime, I would like to quote from Jack's praise of the workers of Canada Post. He said, "I do not think a more diverse group of Canadians could be found anywhere. They come from absolutely every background. Maybe that's why there is a certain appreciation of the importance of the mail. In a way, it is part of the democratic communication process that brought them to Canada in the first place. The notion that people can communicate freely, that they can speak their mind, and that there is a public postal service to make sure people can communicate with each other. Many of them will mention the Charter of Rights and so on that we have here in Canada and how proud they are to be Canadians and to be working on behalf of Canadians. That is why I found it very distressing to see them being partitioned off as though they were somehow not part of the 33 million Canadians. They are as much a part of the 33 million Canadians as anybody else. And, Madam Speaker, they have connected Canadians across the country. Their labour supports an important service for all." Madam Speaker, you may recall that despite opposition by the NDP, the undemocratic back-to-work legislation passed, forcing the workers to accept a less-than-satisfactory agreement. The good news is that in April of 2016, the Ontario Superior Court ruled that the Harper government had infringed upon the Charter Freedom of Association of Union Members by abrogating CUPW members' right to strike. It's heartening to me to know that while we may not consistently be said, it may not be consistently said of the Conservatives and Liberal governments, the courts at least appreciate the value of public service and the protections we have put in place for free and democratic association. Madam Speaker, it's indeed ironic that the Conservatives named their back-to-work legislation the Restoring Mail Delivery for Canadians Act, particularly in light of the fact that they proceeded to enact legislation to suspend home mail delivery to Canadians. The Conservatives did this despite overwhelming opposition to the change, most notably by seniors and disabled Canadians who would find themselves traversing the community mailbox a great difficulty. And who can forget the insensitivity of Canada Post President and CEO Deepak Chopra, who responded to these objections with the statement that seniors could benefit from the exercise. It's shameful, and the callousness of that dismissal of seniors' concerns is breathtaking. The corporation and the government argued that suspension of home delivery was necessary in order to balance the books. The Liberals, under their leader, the member for Papineau, campaigned vociferously and unapologetically in 2015 to restore home mail delivery, that they would be the champions of those for whom home delivery was essential. We know now, Madam Speaker, that this promise was only one in a long line of promises crafted to court votes. And just as the Liberal campaign promises to enact electoral reform, tax reform, and protect the environment, restoration of home mail delivery was thrown on the trash pile of broken promises once the Liberals had cashed in the votes of hopeful Canadians and won their majority government. New Democrats know we can do better, Madam Speaker. New Democrats know the value of affordable, accessible, and sustainable public services are vital to the healthy community and the healthy democracy we want, where everyone has a voice. Which brings me to Motion 166, calling for the formation of a special committee to study a system of postal banking delivered by the Canada Post Corporation and propose a plan for implementation of postal banking within a year. But, Madam Speaker, please allow me to first share some relevant facts and figures. Over 600 municipalities have passed resolutions that support postal banking. Almost two out of every three respondents, 63% of a 2013 Stratcom poll, supported Canada Post expanding revenue-generating services, including financial services like bill payments, insurance, and postal banking. A number of former Canada Post presidents, including Michael Warren, Andre Ouellette, and Moira Green, have considered and even promoted the notion of the corporation getting more involved in financial services. The UPU, a United Nations agency, thinks post offices should be looking at expanding financial services. It's produced a global roadmap for the future. This roadmap calls for the continued development of postal networks along three dimensions: physical, financial, and digital, electronic routes. In 2014, the Liberal Party critic for Canada Post said the merits of postal banking should be explored in the context of several different options for the future of the corporation. Madam Speaker, the Liberal and Conservative members of this House will tell you that we've already studied postal banking and found it to be non-viable. The Harper government suppressed a 2014 study indicating postal banking would be a win-win endeavour for Canada Post and the communities it serves and generate revenues to support other vital services, including home mail delivery. Yet in 2016, the Government Operations Committee conducted a blanket study of Canada Post, including a section on postal banking that deemed it non-viable. All very strange, Madam Speaker. Particularly when New Democrats, Labour and Civic Society had reason to believe the committee's evidence and analysis was flawed and incomplete. It leads one to wonder, Madam Speaker, whether the analysis of postal banking as a viable option for Canada Post conducted in 2016 was influenced by the interests other than those of the public good. Postal banking was part of the fabric of Canadian life for over 100 years. Just following Confederation in 1867, the federal government passed legislation establishing a post office savings bank in order to provide a savings service to the working classes and small town residents. The Canadian postal banking system began operations in 1868 with 81 locations and grew quickly to 343 post office savings banks. Within 16 years, it had a balance of $13 million in almost 67,000 accounts. However, in the 1890s, Canada's postal banking system faced challenges from the chartered banks, which were facing a recession. The banks suddenly became interested in smaller depositors, using post office savings banks, and actively worked to undermine the postal banking. Gradually, the chartered bank lobby was successful in having the interest rate paid on deposits at postal savings banks lowered from 3% to 2.5%, and all but eliminated advertising by postal banks. This was the final straw. The post office savings bank system was closed down in 1969 under the Liberal government of Pierre Trudeau, an unfortunate situation. Madam Speaker, much as any business whose bottom line is profit over public service, corporate banks are content to remain in small communities and remote areas as long as the profits generated there meet their expectations. But as we have learned with the selling off of public services provincially, federally, and municipally, reliance on market-driven public service has its downfalls. When we consider access to banking services, history shows us that as soon as profits diminish, even if they still exist, corporate banks deem them not worthwhile and pull up stakes, affecting remote and rural communities, First Nations communities, and economically depressed areas. Even co-ops such as Desjardins, a proud Quebec institution, has moved services, leaving not much, so much as an ATM where they deemed it not worthwhile. And much the same as selling off public resources such as our rail lines, our power lines, our senior services, and highway systems has demonstrated, the end result is a widening of the gap between those who have and those who have not, making life less and less affordable for everyday Canadians. Every single Canadian deserves access to financial services, and never has this been more evident than today when social benefits are delivered by direct deposit. Lack of access to banking services literally results in an inability to pay the bills. We heard testimony at the United Nations Commission on the Status of Women earlier this month from Francine Joe, president of NWAC, who reported that family members of missing and murdered Indigenous women in Canada have been unable to attend inquiry hearings because they lack the resources to pay their costs up front and do not have bank accounts for the inquiry to reimburse them. So, in this very tragic circumstance, Madam Speaker, lack of access to banking service literally means justice denied to families who had hoped and waited for it for so long. Madam Speaker, we can do better. When we view this gap in service with an intersectional lens, we know that women in remote, rural, and economically depressed regions of Canada suffer negative economic and social impacts disproportionately to men. Equalization of access to banking services in all these areas would allow women better access to financial autonomy. A postal bank could become part of the transformation of the post office branch into a real center for delivering community power. A post office location offering banking could help by offering loans for environmental refits for housing and businesses. Better accessibility to these kinds of services empowers women to become equal community partners. Communities like my own in London, Ontario, have been deeply affected by globalization and unemployment resulting from the government's inability to keep good jobs in Canada. Payday lenders prey on Canadians of low income, charging outrageous interest fees. Postal banking is a sustainable solution that provides accessible banking services across Canada where no service is currently available and to those who cannot afford to or choose not to use corporate banks. Postal banking can generate income to allow Canada Post to provide increased services such as restoration of home delivery to the communities that demand it and count on that service. Communities like my own have also been deeply affected by the insensitivity of corporate banks to their needs. Just this past year, the Toronto Dominion Bank at the corner of Highbury and Hamilton Road in London Fanshawe closed, leaving the residents of that community with no banking alternative. The nearest branch to them is over 12 kilometres away. This is a community of seniors and people with limited incomes, and they now have no bank. TD abandoning them puts these people at the mercy of payday lenders. A Google Street View search of the location shows a boarded up building where the branch used to be. with a Canada Post outlet in the very same strip. Madam Speaker, we can and should do better. Let's make that postal outlet a centre for postal banking for all the people in the neighbourhood. Madam Speaker, my motion, if passed, would allow for an impartial and objective study on postal banking conducted by a special committee that will prove what the rest of the world already knows, that postal banking works. The committee would also be charged to table a plan for implementation of postal banking under Canada Post within 12 months of the motion. Madam Speaker, the Liberals claim to know what's best for Canadians when, in fact, they only serve their corporate and powerful friends. Their tax cuts serve the rich. They refuse to close loopholes that allows billions in revenue to be hidden offshore in tax shelters. They've broken their promise on electoral reform, and their infrastructure bank will put public services under the control of private corporations. Liberals claim to have studied postal banking already and found it flawed, chiefly because it cuts into profits for their corporate banking and business friends. New Democrats know that postal banking is a solution that works, and Madam Speaker, I would ask this House to please support my motion and create equal, accessible, and just banking services for Canadians. Thank you.
Questions and comments?
Questions and commentaires. The Honourable Parliamentary Secretary of the Government, House Leader.
Yes, Madam Speaker, I'm a bit surprised in terms of the manner in which the member concluded her remarks and tries to give a false impression as if the Liberal government has done something in terms of putting or is supporting corporations and not providing tax breaks, when the record would clearly show that nothing is further from the truth. In fact, if anyone's been voting against tax breaks for our middle class and those aspiring to be a part of it and just supporting our lower income people through the child benefit and so much more, it's the NDP in this House that has done that. Now, let me get to the subject of the matter, Mr. Speaker, in regards to Canada Post. Again, misinformation. This the Liberal Party, prior to the election, said that there would be, if we form government, there would be a moratorium. That moratorium was put in place when we formed government. We are no longer seeing mailboxes being, or door-to-door delivery continuing to evaporate. Those that are receiving it continue to receive it. My question to the member is, can she tell this House there was a public task force that went out, what the conclusions were from that public task force on Canada Post, if she's aware of that? And number two would be, does the member, or has the member approached any other committee with this particular resolution to see if any other committee, standing committee of the House, would be interested in pursuing what she's asking us to do?
The RL member for London Fanshawe.
Well, thank you, Madam Speaker. And the only false impression that was created was the one that this government created when it led people to believe that if they voted for this government, that they would get their home mail delivery back. Sure, they put on a moratorium, but 800,000 people, seniors, persons living with handicaps, they cannot access these community boxes when the snow is piled high. And, Madam Speaker, if anyone knows about piling it high, it's that government. I would like to say, in terms of their so-called tax breaks, sure, those who have the most got the most. Tax havens, loopholes, all still there, Madam Speaker. And in fact, in 2005, there was a study. And that study said that postal banking would be an important thing to pursue. They squashed it. In 2016, there was another study. I asked for it, and it was all redacted. They're terrified, Madam Speaker, because their banking friends don't like it.
Questions and comments?